You did tell me.
Because they say it does work. It does work.
Mr. President,
now, personally,
Mr. President, you told me during one of the debates that you would bring back waterboarding and a hell of a lot worse.
I want to keep our country safe. I want to keep our country safe.
What does that
mean?
When
they're shooting, when they're chopping off the heads of our people and other people, when they're chopping off the heads of people because they happen to be a Christian.
So I said to them, they're decapitating people, they're drowning people, and they're chopping off heads.
It's been that way for a long time. In Syria, you have the Christians where their heads are being chopped off randomly and at will, and you have the Muslims who are not Syria. You have to knock out ISIS. They're chopping off heads. These are animals. You have to knock them out. You have to knock them off strong. They're chopping off people's heads in the Middle East, especially if you happen to be Christian. They're chopping off heads, and she's working. The other side, they chop off our young people's heads.
I said, we are living in a world where in the Middle East, they're cutting people's heads off. They're chopping a Christian's head off, and many of them, we talk about... I don't want ISIS. ISIS is bad. They're evil. When they start doing with the head chopping and drowning,
where they could chop off heads.
We'll chop off the heads of the Americans, chop off the heads of the French, chop off the heads of whoever you may bring.
So we can't do waterboarding, but they can do chopping off heads, drowning people in steel cages. They can do whatever they want to do.
The president was one of those Americans who went to church, but he spent a lot of the time this weekend meeting with advisors at the presidential retreat, Camp David. When he returned to the White House, he spoke to the media.
This crusade, this war on terrorism is going to take a while.
20 years after Jerusalem was taken, the Dome of the Rock was seized by a group of warrior monks calling themselves the Knights of the Temple of Solomon, or more simply, the Knights Templars. In Jerusalem, the Templars began to deviate further and further away from the practices of Christianity. They learnt the secret arts of the Kabbalah, an ancient form of Jewish magic, along with its dark rites and rituals. The Jews had learnt the arts from the pagans of ancient Egypt during the times of enslavement to the Pharaoh and developed them into Babylon at the time of Nebuchadnezzar. In 1307, King Philip of France arrested them for charges of denial of Christ, homosexuality, and idol worship, as well as magic. In 1314, Pope Clement V declared all Templars as heretics to Christianity, ordering all their properties to be seized. Their leader, Jacques de Molay, was captured and burnt to the stake. The Templars were cornered, and just when it seemed they were finished forever, a glimmer of hope arose from a seemingly certain end. They were to find a safe haven as well as an ally, but not in France. In fact, in a country in a desperate struggle for independence against the English, the country of Scotland.
The Ayrshire coast today, and a parallel universe from Edinburgh's stark new realities. Hail to the would-be chief! Here to reopen Turnberry, his revamped golf resort, Donald Trump, the ultimate beneficiary of the protest vote.
Basically, they took back their country. That's a great thing.
Mr. Trump, a lovely wave to the crowd and us would be great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Donald Trump has said this project is close to his heart because he doesn't have to reach far back to find his Scottish heritage. His mother was a MacLeod, a proud Scottish clan. In fact, this is their tartan.
In 1717, the Templars made their reappearance in Europe. They had grown in both number and strength, and were now ready to coin a new identity, free from their reputation of the past, and given credibility by none other than the monarchy and aristocracy of England. And the name they chose for themselves was a name that would be known by many, but understood by a few. This new name, the Freemasons. The new identity and the grandeur of its members afforded the Masons with respect and dignity.
All right, that was a clip of Donald Trump from earlier tonight. And right after the debate was over, I spoke with the Republican frontrunner. Take a look. And joining us now, he's still number one in the polls and doing very well on the Drudge Report instant poll results. Donald Trump.
She went on to say something in reference to Freemasons.
She did.
In June 1099,
10,000 Muslims looked on in awe as the Crusaders arrived at the walls of Jerusalem. This city is still at the heart of the struggle for control of the Holy Land, and 900 years ago, it was the Crusaders' ultimate prize.
To understand the Crusades, we must understand, first of all, that this is a spiritual enterprise. It was a brilliant move of the Pope to offer those sinners, who were knights, who were fighting people, a penance which was their greatest passion, which is to kill other people. That is, killing, fighting as a kind of penance.
This the spiritual act, yes, cleansing,
yes,
act.
Yes, cleansing act, yes, and cleansing Jerusalem of pollution by the Saracens, as they called the Muslims.
We will move the American embassy to the eternal capital of the Jewish people, Jerusalem.
If the president follows through on his pledge to move the U.S. embassy in Israel from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, that would essentially be U.S. recognition of Jerusalem as Israel's capital. Palestinian leaders also claim the holy city, and they warn that the embassy switch would be an act of war.
He is the leading 2016 Republican presidential contender. Donald Trump, again, joins us. And I've got so many questions. But first off, Donald, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Alex. Great to be with you.
I've got so many questions, but you are vindicated. This has got to be the 50th time in the last 6 months on the radical Muslims celebrating, not just in New Jersey, but New York, Palestine, all over.
And the people were saying, many of the people from New Jersey, four or five people said, Mr. Trump, I saw it myself. I was there. They talked about Patterson, but they said, I saw it myself, Mr. Trump. I was there.
And all of a sudden, down there, I see this van parked. And I see three guys on top of the van. And I could see that they were, like, happy. You know, they didn't look shocked to me.
And at that point, we were taken for another round of questioning, this time related to our allegedly being members of Mossad. The fact of the matter is, we are coming from a country that experiences terror daily. Our purpose was to document the event. Our purpose was to document the event.
Building is going to collapse. Nothing information. Building is going to collapse. Nothing information.
So many people have called in and on Twitter, at Real Donald Trump, they were celebrating, and they were celebrating the fall of the World Trade Center. I think that's disgraceful.
It is.
He owns ABC. He really does. I mean, George Stephanopoulos interviewed me the other day. It was terrible. It was like, it was one of the great interviews. Did anybody see that interview?
Yeah! Yeah! But, you know, hey, Jews were arrested on 9/11, Trump! Hey, Trump! Jews! Hey, listen to me, Trump! Jews were arrested on 9/11 in New Jersey, not Muslims. Jews! Five Jews, you got it? Five Jews, Charles! Hey, look over me, dude! Hey! Five Jews, Donald! Gassing and raising! Israel did 9/11!
Okay.
Hey, Israel did 9/11, all right?
Okay, sit down.
And that same week you were reporting on that fact, we had two different international football games, soccer games, with the Turkish fans and others during the moment of silence for the dead people in Paris chanting Allah Akbar and booing. So did that not happen too?
How did you and Charlie meet?
Charlie and I met through a mutual friend, Alex Jones. Charlie and I met through a mutual friend, Alex Jones. Alex Jones.
Alex Jones.
Charlie and I met through a mutual friend, Alex Jones.
They picked a fight with a warlock. You're dealing with a Vatican assassin. Sorry.
They picked a fight with a warlock. You're dealing with a Vatican assassin. Sorry.
Charlie and I met through a mutual friend, Alex Jones.
And how long were you together?
Charlie and I dated. We weren't official the first few months, but I would say altogether about 7-8 months.
And how many times, roughly, did you and Charlie engage in intercourse?
You have enough time?
Right. You're dealing with a Vatican assassin. Sorry.
When the Templars installed themselves on the hill where the Temple of Solomon had once stood, it had a profound effect on them, and they began examining it. These researches led them to remains which contained the essence of some secret traditions to the heart of ancient Jewish belief. they encountered a teaching which constituted the pagan aspect of ancient Jewish belief. The Kabbalah.
The Prayer of King Solomon from the Book of Wisdom.
New York's Catholic Archbishop is among 22 men elevated to Cardinal by Pope Benedict Saturday. Timothy Dolan smiled broadly as he approached the Pope. It came a day after he received a heartfelt papal thumbs up for his animated speech to cardinals about spreading the faith.
He said, well, thank you again for yesterday. I said, thank you for this.
With this symbolic military salute, the former Superior General of the Jesuits, Adolfo Nicolás, handed the baton to the next leader of the Society of Jesus, the Venezuelan Arturo Sosa.
It has long been a tradition for a newly elected Superior General to meet with the Pope. It's an opportunity for His Holiness to speak with the Superior of the Society of Jesus to offer wisdom and counsel, and for the Jesuit General to ensure that his leadership is in line with that of the Pontiff. This morning, Pope Francis graced General Congregation 36 with his presence. From a nondescript vehicle and with no entourage, Pope Francis emerged at the Jesuit Curia to speak first with Father General, then to the delegates and staff of GC 36. This wasn't a social call. This was the congregation with newly elected Father General Arturo Sosa presenting themselves before the Bishop of Rome and asking him to guide their discernment towards his vision of the Church. We are the Society of Jesus. We are your servants. We are ready to set the world on fire. Send us. We are the Society of Jesus. We are your servants. We are ready to set the world on fire. Send us.
From the Order of the Sword of Courland, I pledge unto thee 340 souls.
From the Order of Calatrava la Nueva, I pledge 118 souls unto thee.
The Order of Santo Stefano di Toscana pledges 257 souls unto thee.
And from the Order of Malta, 2,457 souls.
The Holy Father has ordered us here. He has promoted you in absentia to the rank of Archbishop, as befits your task. Congratulations, Your Grace. We, the faithful here assembled, form the Knights of the Ninth Crusade. We are yours to command, Archbishop Maxwell. Employ us as you will.
Amen. I accept this with all of my being.
Your target is London. Destroy it!
Let us pray. God of our ancestors and Lord of mercy, you have made all things, and in your providence have charged us to rule the creatures produced by you, to govern the world in holiness and righteousness, and to render judgment with integrity of heart. Give us wisdom, for we are your servants, weak and short-lived, lacking in comprehension of judgment and of laws. Indeed, though one might be perfect among mortals, if wisdom which comes from you be lacking, we count for nothing.
fairly well known in Republican circles. She's a big party donor. She served as the former finance chair of the RNC. She was chair of the Michigan Republican Party. Also one of the country's leading advocates for school vouchers. She's also the sister of Eric Prince. Remember Eric Prince? That name sounds familiar. It's because he is the guy who founded Blackwater.
A full-fledged criminal enterprise executed by the military contractors known formerly as Blackwater, according to the sworn testimony of two of its employees. The nation's Jeremy Scahill, who broke the story, joins us in a moment. The details come straight from two sworn affidavits filed late last night by persons whose identities have been sealed to protect their identity, men who have previously cooperated with federal prosecutors in the criminal inquiry into Blackwater. From John Doe number two, a former member of Blackwater's management team, quoting the affidavit, it appears that Mr. Eric Prince, Blackwater's founder, and his employees murdered or had murdered one or more persons who have provided information or who were planning to provide information to the federal authorities about the ongoing criminal conduct. On several occasions after my departure from Mr. Prince's employ, Mr. Prince's management has personally threatened me with death and violence. John Doe number two also stating that Mr. Prince, pictured here, smuggled unlawful weapons into Iraq, including sawed-off semi-automatic machine guns with silencers and illegal hand grenades. And the affidavit also says that Prince, quote, views himself as a Christian crusader eliminating Muslims and the Islamic faith from the globe. To that end, Mr. Prince intentionally deployed to Iraq certain men who shared his vision of Christian supremacy. Many of these men used call signs based on the Knights of the Templar, the warriors who fought the Crusades. Mr. Prince operated his companies in a manner that encouraged and rewarded the destruction of Iraqi life. Going to Iraq to shoot and kill Iraqis was viewed as a sport or game. Strikingly similar allegations made in the affidavit of John Doe number one, a former U.S. Marine who worked for Blackwater in Iraq. He alleges that incidents of unjustified deadly force were initially videotaped and watched in a session called a hot wash. Blackwater, now known as Z Services, spelled X-E, maintains that Mr. Prince and the company are innocent of any wrongdoing and perform their duties on behalf of their employer, the State Department.
Well, now, Prince has his own ideas on solving that. He doesn't want people plucked out of the Mediterranean Sea. His blueprint in the Financial Times has armed guards on patrol, surveillance planes, quick reaction forces, and medical evacuations, with private contractors there every step of the way. When I put that to Prince himself, though, he told me to back up.
Let me back you up. Maybe we start again. I think that's an inaccurate characterization of the article. The answer is to stop the refugee crisis at the southern border of Libya. Gaddafi built a lot of runways all over the country. So reopening one of those runways and making it a border security base where Libyans are trained and equipped and led, okay, the contractor or the foreign element comes in because they are basically the skeletal system that the body of a Libyan border police grows on. You provide the leadership, communications, intelligence, medical, and logistics support to that unit, and they can stop the refugees. Because the people are not walking. They have to drive. The distances, I mean, Libya is the size of Alaska. So they have to drive. Very easy for an ISR, a simple surveillance aircraft, to find those vehicles, a helicopter to interdict them from the air. That means stop and arrest. The refugees are then held at one of the refugee camps in the south, and they can be repatriated, but they don't get the ticket to Europe.
Mr. Prince, given the legacy of the work that Blackwater did in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and the issues that were fleshed out by some of those involved with the company, do you have any regrets about the work there?
I have great regrets for ever going to work for the State Department. We did exactly the mission they asked us to do. We did more than 100,000 missions. No one under our care was ever killed or injured. And the men used their firearms in less than 0.5% of all those missions while doing the most dangerous personal security detail missions in the world. 41 of our men were killed in action. I regret ever working for the State Department because they were just not worth it for the men that were killed or injured doing that job.
You've reportedly groused that Barack Obama crushed your business, whereas I can only imagine that you think that America's next president, Mr. Donald Trump, would do the opposite himself, like you, a billionaire businessman. Will Trump be good for your fortunes? What are you expecting?
Let me clarify that misreception. I'm far from a billionaire. the company I'm running now, Frontier Service Group, it's not Blackwater at all. None of our men are armed. We do logistics. We deliver groceries including frozen groceries from Cape Town and Durban all the way up through the Democratic Republic of Congo.
We deliver groceries, including frozen groceries from Cape Town and Durban all the way up through the Democratic Republic of Congo. We do aviation out of Malta.
And we are the biggest medevac provider for the UN. So our planes fly in and pull out UN peacekeepers. It is not a defense contractor at all. We're a logistics contractor. But we do it in the most difficult and interesting and challenging places.
12 ayes, 11 nays.
The ayes have it. The nomination will be favorably reported.
Breaking right now at noon, a Senate committee just voting to recommend Betsy DeVos as Secretary of Education. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm Susan Shaw.
I'm Emily Leonard. This vote just happened within the past 15 minutes in Washington.
We are joined right now by our political reporter, Rick Albin, for a look at what happened today and what happens next.
This has been a very tumultuous 11 days of the Trump administration, and this hearing today didn't really provide any surprises. As expected, it was a party line vote. There are more criticism from Democrats and challenges to that criticism from Republicans.
The members of these orders lived a monastic life on the one hand and were trained to wage war against Muslims on the other.
And is it a Muslim ban?
Totally. It's not a Muslim ban, but we were totally prepared. It's working out very nicely. You see it at the airports, you see it all over. It's working out very nicely.
This is the plan to defeat the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. In other words, ISIS. I think it's going to be very successful. Okay, that's big stuff.
President Donald Trump's executive order immediately to ban immigration appears to have taken effect already.
Yesterday it was words, today it appears to be action. We have learned in the last few minutes that two travelers from Iraq are being detained right now at JFK. Eyewitness News reporter Marcus Solis joining us live from the airport with the latest on exactly what is going on here. Marcus.
Well, Rob, lawyers have been busy trying to get these two Iraqi refugees admitted into the country, one with a special immigration visa that was assigned the day President Trump took the oath of office. But nevertheless, these two men arrived on separate flights last night and have been here at Terminal 4 at the International Arrivals Terminal since, being stopped by customs agents.
Politicians getting involved today in the protests. Brian Yenes has been following this developing story for us all day long, live from JFK International Airport in Queens. So, Brian, what's happening out there now? I see the crowds are still pretty thick.
Hi, Julie. Well, this protest, this outrage from these protesters started at about noon today with about 10 people. Look behind me now. We are outside Terminal 4 at JFK. There are hundreds and hundreds of people who are here demanding the release of at least 11 people who are being held inside of Terminal 4 here at JFK. These people are people who had visas and paperwork to come into the United States. They boarded their flights, and then when they arrived here, they were detained because of Trump's, President Trump's executive order banning travel from those seven Muslim majority countries.
They said, we are living in a world where in the Middle East they're cutting people's heads off. They're chopping a Christian's head off, and many of them, we talk about, I don't want ISIS. ISIS is bad, they're evil. When they start doing with the head chopping and drowning thing where they could chop off heads. When I was a young man, I studied medieval times. That's what they did. They chopped off heads.